Welcome. This presentation will give us a little background in shared vocabulary for this class, as well as introducing a few concepts for analyzing data. In statistics, we often use everyday English words in a very precise and technical way. The best I can do is to apologize on behalf of the field and ask you to bear with us and pay a close attention. Let's begin. Statistics is a field of study that lets us make sense of a world using data. Let's begin there. What is data? Of course, data is any information we choose to collect. But I like to go a little bit further. In the modern world, data is central to our understanding. If you want to run a business with only 5 clients, there is no need for statistical techniques to address them. Just talk to your 5 customers. But in an increasingly interconnected and complicated world, many companies have far too many customers to know each individually. They must look at the data to understand their customers at all. Statistics involves collecting, classifying, summarizing, organizing, analyzing, and interpreting numerical information. Based on the numerical information from data, we will learn to make educated guesses. I would like you to understand how several of our vocabulary terms relate to each other. The first pair is population and sample. A population is a set of units, usually people, objects, transactions, or events that we are interested in studying. It is the totality of items or things under consideration. A sample is a subset of units of a population. It is the portion of the population that is selected for analysis. For example, population may be everyone between the ages of 18 and 24 living in the US, or all the students at Oregon State University, or every sale a company makes in January. If that population is tiny, all members of your immediate family, or all customers in the store at 8 a.m., we may use the whole population as our sample. This is called a census, but it is extremely rare. More often, we choose just a few customers to talk to in greater detail or sales to audit. This smaller group is called a sample. We usually sample at random to avoid bias to ensure that the sample is a good representative of the entire population. This is an Excel spreadsheet documenting all the employees in a large company. The population for this example is all the employees in this company. The sample will be those that are randomly selected and highlighted in red. Sample size is typically much smaller than the population size. Next pair is parameter and statistic. A parameter is a numerical descriptive measure of a population. It is a summary measure that is computed to describe a characteristic of the entire population. A statistic is a numerical descriptive measure of a sample. It is a summary measure calculated from the observations in the sample. A parameter is a fact about a population. Say, about half of the employees in the aforementioned company are female, while a statistic is something we actually measure about a sample. For instance, 82 out of 150 employees are sampled were women. This graph shows how the populations and samples relate. For now, you may ignore the mathematical symbols in the circles and boxes. We start from the circle on the very top and follow the direction of arrows, which is clockwise. The relationship between population and sample is also a central paradox in statistics. We care about the population, say all of our customers, but it's impractical or impossible to collect all the information from all of them. So instead, we collect the information from a sample, which is taken at random. There's nothing particularly special about these random selected samples, except that they can tell us about the whole population. But that's a very big deal, to allow us to have some understanding of the whole by looking at just a part of the population. In this process flow, we start with some numerical measure about the whole population, which is described by a population parameter. Then we select the small sample at random, to see how that idea holds up. We do some calculations based on the sample statistics and use that to draw conclusions for the population parameter. Sometimes, we also repeat this cycle many times to update our beliefs about the population. Example 1. A manufacturer of computer chips claims that less than 10% of his products are defective. When 1,000 chips were drawn from a large production, 7.5% were found to be defective. The population of interest is all computer chips from this large production. The sample is 100 chips that were drawn. Parameter is 10%, and statistic is 7.5%. When we think about data, we tend to divide data into numerical and categorical data. Numerical data, also known as quantitative data, is described by numbers. Think quantities like age, household income, starting salary, checking account balance. Categorical data, also known as qualitative data, on the other hand, has typically no numbers but categories associated with it. Think quantities like honest, gender, registered to vote, merit, finance majors versus non-finance majors. We will have different tools to deal with numerical and categorical data in this class. In this example, salary, age, and experience are all numerical variables, whereas gender, training levels are categorical variables. The commonly used methods to summarize categorical data include pie chart, bar graph, and a frequency table. The first two present graphs to summarize the count information for each category. In our example, that's just female and male. Frequency table provides the detailed percentages of the subjects in each group. For numerical data, there are much more different number of ways to summarize them. There are largely three different types of measures for numerical data: location, spread of variability, and relative standing. Let's focus on these various measures for location first. The first measure for location is mean. That's also known as the sample average, basically summing up all the numbers in the sequence and find the average of those. Sample mean is typically denoted using x with a bar on top of it, called x bar. Median is also a frequently used measure for location. To find a median, we would have to sort all observations from the smallest to the largest. If the sample size n is odd, median is going to be the number that's right in the middle. If the sample size n is even, median is going to be the average of the middle two observations. This is an example for finding the median of a set of observations. The sample size is 6, which is even. The median is the average of middle two observations. Therefore, median is the average of 4 and 4, so that is also 4. Mean and median are fairly similar concepts, but they behave rather differently in the presence of extreme observations, which are very large or very small observations compared to the rest. Which one of them is more sensitive to extreme observations? In other words, which would change more in the presence of extreme observations? Median is usually not affected by extreme observations at all, because median is the middle values of the sorted series. On the other hand, mean is more sensitive to extreme observations. Let's continue with the remaining measures of location. Mode is the value of measurement that occurs most frequently in the dataset. It might not be unique or not even exist. For the toy example we looked at early on, 4 occurs twice in this series, while all other values only occur once. So 4 is the mode. You may probably have heard the word bimodal or multimodal, which represent that the set of observations have two modes or multiple modes respectively. The Dupre percentile is the observation such that p percent of all observations fall below it. Also means 100 subtract p percent of observations fall above it. Quartiles are some special percentiles. For example, Q1 is the lower quartile, that is also the 25th percentile. Q2 is that also the 50th percentile, that's also the median, which is the middle observation. Q3 is the upper quartile, and also the 75th percentile. This is an example to demonstrate how to find the various quartiles for a set of observations. So first, we need to sort off all the observations. And then the first quartile is the 25th percentile. Second quartile is the median. And third quartile is the 75th percentile. Let's move on to various measures for spread. I'm going to talk about range and interquartile range first. Range is the difference between the largest observation and the smallest observation. Interquartile range is also known as IQR. That is the distance between Q3, the upper quartile, and Q1, the lower quartile. I'm going to use the following example to explain variance and standard deviation. A travel agent sampled 6 hotels from Portland and 6 hotels from Detroit. The hotel rates are given here. I also plotted them on 2 number lines. The sample means for both cities are $70. By comparing at the locations of the 6 hotels in Portland and that of the 6 hotels in Detroit, it appears that the spread of Portland hotel rates is bigger than that of Detroit hotels. So whatever measure for spread we're going to use later on, we would like to have that measure to carry a bigger value for Portland hotels than Detroit hotels. Let's talk about the first measure of spread, variance. To find a variance, we would need to find a sample mean, x-bar, first. And then we would calculate the squared distance between each individual observation x with x-bar. Sum up that square differences, and then divide by the sample size minus 1. Sample variance is typically denoted by s-square. Standard deviation, also known as STD, is just the square root of variance. Alternatively, variance is the squared standard deviation. This is a worksheet to calculate the standard deviation for Detroit. That's going to be the number 6 in the worksheet. To find number 6, we would start from number 1 first. That's going to be the sample size. And then move on to number 2. That's the sample mean. And then number 3, the difference between each individual x and x bar. And then the square distance for number 4. And then we're going to sum them up and divide it by sample size minus 1. And don't forget to take square root of that to get the very last entry. And that's going to be the sample standard deviation. The standard deviation, or the STD for Detroit, is about 3.69. We repeat the same calculations for Portland next. The standard deviation for Portland is found to be 37.02, which is clearly bigger than that for Detroit, as we have expected. The last type of measure is for relative standing. We will focus on only one measure of relative standing here, that's the z-score, which is equal to the observation subtract the center and then divided by the spread. The center here is usually the mean, and the spread is usually the standard deviation. Z-score tells us how far this particular observation is above or below the center of the series. This distance is also measured in terms of the spread, how many standard deviations away. For the hotel example we worked on earlier, to find a z-score for each of the 6 hotels in Detroit, we would have to find a sample mean and a sample standard deviation for the 6 hotels in Detroit first. They are 70 and 3.6878 respectively. Using those two numbers, we can find a z-score for each of the 6 hotels. For example, the second hotel costs $73 per night. 73 is the observation. I subtract the mean of 70 from 73 and divide by 3.6878 to get a z-score of 0.81. I repeat the same calculations for the hotels in Detroit. When I work on the hotels in Portland, I would have to subtract the individual hotel rate by the mean of 70 and divide by the standard deviation of 37.0189 to get their respective z-scores. It is also important to notice that the mean and the standard deviation are group features, whereas the z-score is an individual feature that varies across different individual observations. Let's consider the ages for all employees in a large company. The z-score of each individual employee measures the distance that can be positive or negative between that employee's age and the mean age in terms of number of standard deviations. For the oldest employee, this is going to be definitely a large positive number because the oldest employee's age is more than the mean age. So the numerator for the z-score is going to be a positive number. Whereas for the youngest employee, his age is less than the mean age, so his z-score is going to be a negative number.